Hi guys, welcome back to my channel. It's Doc Janelle. The subject at hand is FAPC, and this is the third part of our respiratory physiology. So, as I always say when we talked about respi physio, makinig at wag bibitaw kasi pag hindi natin naintindihan yung una, maaari hindi na natin maintindihan yung middle until yung last part. Okay? So, let's talk about pulmonary circulation. First, we'll be talking about the function of the anatomy ng pulmonary circulatory system. So, we still remember the pulmonary vessels, no? Ang ating pulmonary artery, if you still remember, it is connected to your right ventricle, di ba? It is 5 centimeters above your right ventricle. And from the pulmonary trunk, magdi-divide yan into left and then right pulmonary arteries, no? Of course, yung left branch pupunta yan sa left lung, while the right branch will go to the right lung. So anong gagawin nila papunta sa artery? Blood will be brought to the lungs for it to be oxygenated. Okay? So the pulmonary artery is actually very thin. Ang thickness niya, 1/3 lang compared sa thickness ng aorta. So, anong sinasabi sa atin nun? That the pulmonary artery is a very distensible blood vessel. Ibig sabihin, kapag maraming blood ang nandoon sa right ventricle, kaya mag-expand ng pulmonary artery natin para ma-accommodate yung stroke volume na lumalabas from the right ventricle. So, malaki yung compliance. Pag sinabi natin compliance, di ba? Yung ability to expand. So, since malaki yung compliance niya, it only has a very low pressure, no? 7 ml per millimeter mercury. Anyway, pupuntahan natin yung pressure na yan in a little while. Next, we have the pulmonary veins. Ang pulmonary veins natin, ang trabaho nila to bring back blood pabalik ng left atrium. And specifically, ang daladala nila, oxygenated blood. They are very short na mga blood vessels, no? And they immediately empty their contents to the left atrium. And of course, pagdating ng left atrium, the blood will be brought to the left ventricle and then it will be pumped for systemic circulation. So, here is a new blood vessel which I want you to be familiar with. These are your bronchial vessels. So, i-orient muna natin. This is your trachea. Now, this is your vertebrae. Tapos, ito yung right main bronchus, left main bronchus. Tapos, ito yung mga branches ng ating bronchi. No, yan yung mga branches nila. Now, if you will notice, itong mga blood vessel na to, itong mga parang dotted line, those are your bronchial vessels. San sila nang gagaling? They come directly from the aortic arch. Diyan sila galing mismo sa aortic arch. So, kung doon sila galing, anong daladala nilang blood? Oxygenated blood. Diba? Kasi ang pupunta sa aorta, oxygenated blood from the left ventricle. So, branches pala yung mga bronchial vessels na yan ng aortic arch natin. So, they deliver oxygenated blood to the lungs. So, hindi sa loob ha, kundi doon sa exterior portion ng ating lungs. Okay? At ang laman nala na blood is equivalent to 1 to 2% of the total cardiac output. So, this bronchial arterial blood is oxygenated blood and it supplies, katulad ng sabi ko sa inyo, the supporting tissues of the blood. Okay? Ang sinusupplyan niya yung connective tissue, yung septa, the large and even the small bronchi. Eventually, after niya mag-provide ng blood doon, it will empty the blood papunta ng pulmonary vein at si pulmonary vein pupunta kay left atrium, di ba? And then, it will flow in the left atrium and then left ventricle. Okay? So, ganun nangyayari yung ating blood supply. Another important thing that you have to understand about the lungs is the presence of our lymphatics. Anong trabaho ng lymphatics? I'm sure nakikita nyo na to in our previous discussion. Sila yung parang mga green, no? Na parang mga vessels din. The job of the lymphatic system is to return excess fluid from the capillaries to the circulation. So, minsan kasi may mga fluid tayo from the blood na nakakatakas from the blood vessels. They exit the blood vessels and they go to our tissues, they go to our muscles, no? So, it is the lymphatics job to return those excess fluid pabalik ng circulation. So, the lymphatic fluid, yung fluid na yun, yung excess fluid, we call it lymph. The lymph found on the right side of the body will be drained towards the right lymphatic duct. At yung right lymphatic duct, it will empty into the right subclavian vein. While the lymph coming from the left side of the body will drain to the thoracic duct and then it will drain to the left subclavian vein. So, in the lymphatics, ang pinaka-ultimate drainage is the subclavian. Pero there is a difference between the left and the right, no? In the right, ang unang pupuntahan, right lymphatic. But in the left, ang pupuntahan, thoracic duct. So, plasma protein leaking from the lung capillaries are also removed from the lungs to prevent pulmonary edema. So, I want you to remember at this point, anong ibig sabihin ng bullet na to? Where protein is, water will be. Again, where protein is, water will be. So, if the protein leaks from the lung capillaries, meaning pag nakaalis or nakalabas yung ating proteins mula sa ating blood vessels, makakatakas din yung water. Kasi where protein is, water will also be. So, it is the lymphatics job to remove itong excess fluid na to or else there will be pulmonary edema, which later on we will also go to and discuss. Now, all of those structures that we mentioned will have different pressures, no? Yung right ventricle natin, yung pulmonary artery, pulmonary vein, etc. All of them will have their own pressures. So let's study about them. Here is a diagram showing us what I wanted to focus on is this one, no? Ito yung pressure curve ng right ventricle. Okay? Itong black and yung red na yan. Okay? So, ito yung kanyang pressure curve. Itong red only, this is the pressure curve of the pulmonary artery. Mamaya natin yan pupuntahan. And on top, you see here also the pressure curve of the aorta. So obviously, ang taas ng pressure sa aorta, tas ito lang yung pressure sa right ventricle and pulmonary artery. No? So the systolic pressure of the right ventricle, so kapag nagsistole, when the right ventricle contracts, the pressure in the right ventricle reaches a level of 25 millimeters mercury. Again, when the right ventricle contracts, it reaches 25 millimeters mercury. But when the right ventricle is relaxed, ang level niya is 0 to up until 11. Yung black na yan, no? 0 to 11 during relaxation. Please note that 25 tsaka 0 to 11, these are only 1/5 of the value in the left ventricle. So, pinuprove lang sa atin ito that the pressures in the right ventricle are much lower compared to the left ventricle. Kita naman natin dito sa aorta, saka pulmonary artery pa lang, di ba? So, I want you to remember, the pressure in the right ventricle is 25 millimeters mercury. Remember that. So now, let's go to the pressure in the pulmonary artery. Let's just focus on this red line here to sa diagram natin. So during systole, No? Pag nag-contract ang right ventricle, anong trabaho ng right ventricle? I-deliver yung blood from the right ventricle towards the pulmonary artery. So during systole, the pressure in the pulmonary artery must be equal to the right ventricle pressure. Diba? Remember, during systole, the right ventricle should be able to overcome the pressure in the pulmonary artery para mabuksan yung valve. So, once they become equal, yung pressure sa loob ng right ventricle and pulmonary artery, then the valves will open and the blood will flow. Kaya, nag-join together dito sa systole, yung ating right ventricular and pulmonary artery curve. Yan. Kaya sila nag-join because they will become equal. After systole, the pulmonary valve will immediately close. Eh, magsasara agad, right at this point. And if you will notice, yung right ventricular pressure, it immediately went down, di ba? Biglang bumaba siya. But the pulmonary arterial pressure, hindi siya agad bumaba. Mas slowly yung kanyang pagbaba. And why does it become, or why is the pressure slowly going down? Because blood is still flowing through. No, blood is still flowing through the capillaries of the lungs during this point. Okay? So may blood flow pa kasi, kaya mabagal yung kanyang pagbaba. So again, during systole, the pressure of the pulmonary artery is equal to the pressure of the right ventricle. So pareho silang 25 millimeters mercury. During diastole, the pulmonary arterial pressure is around 8 millimeters mercury. No? So, ang mean nun, yung middle value of 25 and 8 is 15. Okay, so balikan lang natin. Right ventricle during systole, 25. During diastole, 0 to 11. Sa pulmonary artery during systole, equal sila ni right ventricle, 25. During diastole, 8. At ang mean ay 15. So here is another image showing that. This is the pulmonary artery pressures. Systole, 25. Diastole, 8. Mean is 15. Okay? Ang ating, yan pa lang so far. Okay? I don't wanna get ahead, okay? So, the mean pulmonary capillary pressure, so sa pulmonary capillaries natin, 7 millimeters mercury. Okay? 7 millimeters mercury doon sa mga pulmonary capillaries where nangyayari ang blood, ang ating blood, gas exchange, yan, 7 millimeters mercury. And later, we will see the importance of this mean pulmonary capillary pressure and how it will relate to fluid exchange functions. So, right now, we know four values, 25, 15, 8, and then also the 7 pulmonary capillaries. Now, let's go to the left atrium and the pulmonary venous pressures. Okay? So, ang mean pressure daw in the left atrium and also in the pulmonary vein. Kasi connected yan, di ba? Pulmonary vein will bring back blood papunta ng left atrium. So, in the left atrium and in the pulmonary veins, the normal pressure there is only, look at this, no? Ito yung pressure ng left atrium. It's only 2 millimeters mercury. So, very low. Very low talaga yung pressure sa left atrium, no? Kasi ventricle yung mataas. Low yung pressure sa left atrium. And it can even go as low as 1 millimeter mercury and only as high as 5 millimeters mercury. Ganun lang kababa. Now, to tell you the truth, the left atrial pressure really cannot be measured. Kasi mahirap puntahan yung left atrium. So, how were they able to measure na 2 millimeters mercury lang siya? They were able to only estimate it using a measurement called pulmonary wedge pressure. Again, ang left atrium, sabi natin, it's only 2 millimeters mercury. But it's very hard to measure the pressure in the left atrium. So, how were they able to determine that it's only 2 millimeters mercury. They were able to get that by measuring the pulmonary wedge pressure. So let's talk about the pulmonary wedge pressure. So first, a catheter will be inserted from the right atrium and it will be pushed until it wedges in the small branch of the left atrium. So sundan natin to, no? Una, pumasok siya sa right atrium, pumunta ng right ventricle, aakit ng pulmonary artery, no? Pulmonary artery here, until mapunta siya doon sa area malapit sa ating left atrium. Okay? So, dyan siya, sa small branch na yan. Okay? And then, pag nandun na siya, pressure will be measured in that area. So, you call that the wedge pressure. And usually, ang nakukuwang amount or nakukuwang measurement ng wedge pressure is 5 millimeters mercury. Okay, 5 millimeter yung measurement. Now, the wedge pressure is usually 2 to 3 millimeters greater than the real left atrial pressure. So, mataas daw yung wedge pressure ng 2 to 3 millimeters mercury. So, ang gagawin mo para makuha mo yung left atrial pressure, you get the wedge pressure and subtract 2 to 3 millimeters mercury. So, let's say 5 ang nakuha. 5 minus 2 or 3. Then your answer will be 3 or 2 millimeters mercury. Kaya nakuha yung 2 kanina. Kaya nakuha yung ito, the 2 millimeters mercury or this one. Kasi wedge pressure minus yung 2 to 3 millimeters mercury. Thus, kapag tumaas ang left atrial pressure, tataas din ang pulmonary wedge pressure. Okay? So, this pulmonary wedge pressure is also used to clinically study yung pulmonary capillary pressures, even the left atrial pressures, and usually mahalaga yung mga values na yan if we have a congestive heart failure patient. So, I think there are some of you that need... Ah, hindi, wala pala. Yan, okay. So, now that we're done with the blood vessels and even the pressures found in the blood vessels and all, let's talk about the blood volume of the lungs. Ang total blood volume in the lungs is 450 ml. Okay? 450 ml. In the pulmonary capillaries, ang laman nila na blood ay 70 ml. So, what I want you to understand is that the lungs does not only function for oxygenation, but it is also a blood reservoir. Meaning, kapag nangailangan ang katawan natin ng extra amount of blood, the lungs will provide that extra amount needed. This is an example. When a person blows out air so hard that high pressure is built up in the lungs, such as pag nagda-trumpet ka, no? When you blow a trumpet, syempre yung lungs mo sobrang mag-e-expand yan. Pag nag-expand yung lungs mo ng todo, high pressure will be built up. So, pag may high pressure, matutulak yung blood out of the lungs. So, when you do that, 250 ml of blood can be expelled from the pulmonary papunta ng systemic circulation. Thus, when there is loss of blood, let's say pag nagka-hemorrhage, no, kayang mag-compensate ng body by shifting blood from the lungs papunta ng systemic vessels, okay? So, basically, yung lungs natin, nagsiserve daw siya as a parang reservoir, parang ano, extra source of blood in the body. Now, that is important because blood can, this shifting of blood, no, from the pulmonary to the systemic can happen not only when we use the trumpet or not only when there is a hemorrhage, but this also happens as a result of cardiac disease. So, pwede rin mangyari, guys, no, na magkakaroon ng shifting of blood from pulmonary to systemic or systemic to pulmonary pag meron tayong heart problem, such as when there is failure of the left side of the heart. Ito tinatawag natin na heart failure, specifically of the left side, or other doctors would call it left-sided heart failure. Oh, ayan. So, ano nangyayari sa left-sided heart failure? Sira, let's say, yung mitral valve, no? Hindi gumagana yung mitral valve. So, saan ba nakikita yung mitral valve? It is found between your left atrium and left ventricle. So, if sira ang ating mitral valve, hindi makakapunta yung blood from the left atrium to the left ventricle. So, ito yung left atrium, ito yung left ventricle. So, galit si left ventricle kasi kailangan na niya ng blood para ma-pump sa systemic circulation. However, the mitral valve is sira. So, blood that is brought to the left atrium cannot go to the left ventricle. So, what will happen? Blood will dam up in the pulmonary circulation. So, mangyayari, maiipon yung dugo sa left atrium. Pag sobrang dami ng blood sa left atrium, mag-overflow na rin yun papulik sa pulmonary vein. Pag puno na yung pulmonary vein mo, babalik na yung blood sa lungs natin. Okay? It will dam up or it will be stored in your pulmonary vessels or pulmonary circulation. Thus, the pulmonary blood volume can increase by 100%. Sabihin, pwedeng yung buong lungs mo punong-puno ng blood. And when that happens, you will increase the pulmonary vascular pressures to the point that yung volume ng systemic circulation mo ay 9 times sa pulmonary system. Imagine, sobrang baba na ng pressure mo sa systemic circulation, 9 times naman sa pulmonary system. Okay? So, in a left-sided heart failure, pag hindi makaflow ang blood from left atrium to left ventricle, may ipon ng blood in the left atrium. Tapos, pag punong-puno na siya, ibabalik na niya yung blood papunta kay pulmonary vein kasi doon galing yung blood, di ba? Tapos, pag puno na si pulmonary vein, ibabalik na ni pulmonary vein papunta kay lungs yung blood. Pag si lungs na puno na ng blood, tataas na yung pressure by 9 times. Okay? So, that will lead to several symptoms as you can see in this image. So, yung blood flow kasi natin in the lungs is essentially equal to the cardiac output. Okay? So, dapat equal yung cardiac output and blood flow to the lungs. Dapat pantay. However, the factors that control cardiac output also control pulmonary blood flow. So, sabi natin kanina, di ba, yung pulmonary vessels natin, specifically pulmonary artery, no, they are distensible tubes, expandable tubes. Di ba? They are expandable tubes. They enlarge with increasing pressure and they narrow with decreasing pressure. Also, they make sure that there is adequate aeration of the blood. Okay? So, tahan natin to. When the concentration of oxygen in some alveoli will decrease, hindi buong lang sa, kung meron kang 10 alveoli at 5 doon nag-decrease ang oxygen, let's just say, no? Nag-decrease ang oxygen in some of that alveoli to less than 70% or specifically below 73 millimeters mercury. What will happen? So normally guys, no? Normally kapag bumababa ang oxygen, ang dapat gawin ng body mo is to dilate the blood vessels. Bakit idadilate? Para there will be more blood flow. Tama, no? Pag mababa ang oxygen, ang tendency, normal tendency ng body is to dilate the blood vessels to increase the blood flow. But in the lungs, look at this. In the lungs, pag bumaba ang oxygen in some of your alveoli, the adjacent blood vessels will constrict. Iko-constrict niya. And how will it constrict? It will increase vascular resistance by 5 times. especially during extremely low oxygen levels. And as mentioned, this is an opposite effect to what normally happens. So bakit ganun yung lungs natin? Bakit opposite nung normal ang ginagawa niya? Wala nang oxygen, lalo pa niyang pipigilan yung blood flow. No? Before we go to that, paano nangyayari yung constriction na to? The lung tissues will release substances that will promote constriction. So yung lungs mismo ang nagpo-promote at gumagawa ng chemicals to constrict it. So why does it do that? Ito na. It does that to distribute blood flow where it is most effective. So, kinoconstrict niya yung blood flow doon sa mga alveoli na walang oxygen in order to cause the blood to flow through other areas of the lungs that are better aerated. Ibig sabihin, kaya niya pinipigilan yung blood na pumunta doon sa mga alveoli na mababa ang oxygen para ang blood pumunta na lang sa areas of the lungs na may better oxygen. So, it will provide an automatic control system to distribute blood flow doon sa areas of the lungs na maraming oxygen. So, para magkaroon ng oxygen yung blood na yon, no, dadalhin na lang niya sa area na maraming oxygen. Okay? Ganon sa lungs natin. Baliktad siya ng nangyayari in the rest of the body. So, another concept that we have to understand about the lungs, no, is that yung concept ng hydrostatic pressure. Okay? Hydrostatic pressure. So, paano maintindihan natin yan ganito? Yung BP or blood pressure daw sa paa ng isang taong nakatayo, is 90 millimeters mercury greater than yung BP niya at the level of the heart. So, bakit mas mataas yung BP natin sa paa pag nakatayo tayo compared sa BP malapit sa puso natin? It's because of hydrostatic pressure and of course, gravity. Do you know that it has a same effect pero to a lesser degree in the lungs? Okay. So, ang lungs natin is 30 centimeters, no? 30 centimeters yung difference ng highest point and the lowest point. So, this 30 centimeters is equivalent to a 23 millimeters mercury difference. Meaning, pag kinuha mo yung BP sa taas at kinuha mo yung BP sa baba, may kita mo na may 23 millimeters mercury difference. Mas mataas yung BP sa baba compared sa yung BP sa taas ng ating lungs. Okay? Hopefully, naintindihan natin yun. So, parang tao din siya, yung lungs natin na naka-upright, nakatayo. Mas mataas yung pressure sa baba because of hydrostatic pressure and gravity compared sa taas. And the difference is a total of 23 millimeters mercury. So, yung heart, yung ating basihan, di ba? The heart is the level, yung normal level. So, sabi natin, itong 23 millimeters pressure difference, paano siya nadi-divide? 15 millimeters is above the heart. So, yung BP na nakukuha sa heart, it has a 15 millimeter difference above the heart. At yung BP na nakukuha below the heart is 8 millimeters different compared to the one from the heart. Okay? Medyo confusing yon, ulitin ko. So, di ba, may BP tayo from the heart. Tapos sabi natin, yung lungs parang upright person din siya. There is more BP towards the lower part compared to the upper part. At pag pinag-compare mo yung upper and lower, there is a total of 23 millimeters mercury difference. Now, if you compare the BP of the heart to the BP of the upper part of the lungs, there is a 15 millimeters difference. And if we compare the BP of the heart to the lower part of the lungs, there is an 8 millimeter difference. Okay. So, yung BP na tinutukoy natin is pulmonary arterial pressure. Pulmonary arteries, di ba? Naalala pa ninyo si pulmonary arteries kanina? Teka, balikan natin si pulmonary artery. there, pulmonary artery natin. Balikan natin yung pressure niya. Pulmonary artery, di ba? Systolic, 25. Pulmonary artery, 25. Median, 15. And then, diastolic, 8. Yan si pulmonary artery. So, balik na tayo doon sa ating hydrostatic. So, in the uppermost portion of the lungs of a standing person, the pulmonary arterial pressure is 15 millimeters mercury less than the pulmonary arterial pressure at the level of the heart. So, ano ulit yung pulmonary pressure, pulmonary arterial pressure of the heart? 25 during systole. Remember? 25 during systole. Kakapakita ko lang sa inyo. So, kapag kinuha mo daw yung pulmonary arterial pressure above the heart, it's 15 millimeters less. Okay? 15 millimeters less. Sorry? And if we get the pressure below the heart, it's 8 millimeters greater than 25 millimeters mercury. So, this pressure difference will have a profound effect on the blood flow to the different areas of the lungs. So, may effect pala yun, that pressure difference, sa kung gaano kadaming blood ang pumupunta sa upper part and sa lower part ng ating lungs. Okay? So, hopefully, malinaw so far. So, here is another proof of that, your figure 38.3, which shows us that in a person at rest, there is more blood flow towards the bottom of the lungs, diba? Hydrostatic pressure, compared to the blood flow at the top of the lungs. Okay? So, there is around 5 times more blood flow towards the bottom due to hydrostatic pressure as compared to the top. And this shows us that the lungs can be divided into 3 zones. Top, middle, and bottom. Let's go to that. Okay, so now we'll go to the internal part of the lungs. So the capillaries that are found near our alveoli are distended or ini-expand sila by the BP inside the capillary. Pero simultaneously, habang ini-expand sila ng BP inside the capillary, kinocompress naman sila by that alveolar air outside, no? So, dalawa yung na-experience ng capillaries natin. Ini-expand sila by the BP flowing inside them at kinocompress naman sila by the alveolar air outside of them. So, anytime that the lung alveolar air pressure becomes greater than the capillary blood pressure. So, yung air pressure is the one that compresses, no, your capillaries. What will happen? Pag mas malakas yung compressing power, the capillaries will close and there will be no blood flow. So, in order for blood flow to happen inside the capillaries of the alveoli, the lung alveolar air pressure should be lesser than the capillary blood pressure. Okay? If hindi natin naintindihan, I want you to rewind what I just said. So, because of this, it created 3 zones in our lungs. Specifically, zone 1, zone 2, and zone 3. Dahil doon sa alveolar air pressure and capillary blood pressure, yung dynamics nun, yung interaction nilang dalawa, it created 3 zones. First, I want to discuss zone 1. This is the reference image, no? In zone 1, there is no blood flow during all portions of the cardiac cycle. So, whether systole or diastole, walang blood flow na nangyayari doon sa capillaries. Why? Because the alveolar capillary pressure, so yung pressure sa loob daw ng capillary, it never rises higher than the alveolar air pressure. So sabi kakasabi lang natin, di ba? If mas mataas ang alveolar air pressure than the capillary blood pressure, no blood flow. So basically, ganun yung zone 1. Mas mataas yung alveolar air pressure kaya nakukompress niya yung capillary. Thus, there is no blood flow. In zone 2, there is intermittent blood flow. Anong meaning nun? Na ang nangyayari during systole, during heart contraction, the capillary blood pressure becomes greater than the alveolar air pressure. So every time the heart beats, na-overcome ng capillary blood pressure yung compressing factor ng alveolar air pressure. So during heart contraction, pag mas mataas yung capillary blood pressure, nakaka-flow ang blood. But during diastole, balik na ulit sa normal, na no blood flow. Kaya intermittent. Kasi on-off yung blood flow. In zone 3, there is continuous blood flow. Why? Because the capillary pressure is always greater than the alveolar air pressure regardless of the cardiac cycle. So whether systole or diastole, talagang mas mataas yung capillary blood pressure. Kaya tuloy-tuloy yung blood flow. So again, zone 1, no blood flow. Zone 2, intermittent blood flow. Zone 3, continuous blood flow. Ngayon, paano natin i-apply yan sa lungs? Normally, our lungs only have zones 2 and 3. So intermittent and continuous lang daw ang meron sa ating lungs, no? Zone 2 and 3 only. Yung zone 2 or yung intermittent flow, you will see that in the apex of the lungs, meaning sa upper part ng lungs natin. And yung zone 3, you will see that in the lower part of the lungs. So if you still remember yung kaninang ano natin, yung kanina nating graph to, yan, no? Kaya totoo tong graph na to, no, that the upper part of the lungs, konti lang yung blood flow kasi intermittent blood flow lang. Compared to the bottom, continuous yung blood flow natin. Diba? So let me just go back to that slide where I just came from. There you go. So here is just a summary of what we mentioned. Zone 1, no flow. Kasi ang air pressure is greater than arterial pressure or capillary pressure. Zone 2, intermittent. Kasi during systole, ang capillary pressure or arterial pressure is higher than alveolar air. And then in zone 3, continuous, kasi always greater ang capillary pressure compared to air pressure. So, now that we know that, yung blood flow in our lungs, no, i-apply ulit natin yung knowledge natin of the pressures. Okay, dito medyo magiging challenging. So, in an upright person, pag nakatayo ang isang tao, the pulmonary arterial pressure at the apex, again, no, yung pulmonary arterial pressure at the apex is 15 millimeters less than yung pulmonary arterial pressure. Balikan lang natin. Pulmonary arterial pressure in the heart is 25 millimeters mercury during systole. Remember, pulmonary arterial pressure during systole, 25 millimeters. Balikan ko para mas maalala natin. Yan. Diba? Pulmonary arterial pressure, 25. Ito pa yung isang picture. 25 during systole. Yan. Okay. So, at the apex, yung pressure is 15 millimeters less than the normal, which is found in the heart. So, ang mangyari, 25, which is found in the heart, less than 15 in the apex, ang total pressure during systole sa apex ay 10 millimeters mercury. So, 10, di ba? This apical systolic pressure of 10 is greater than the zero alveolar air pressure. So, ilan ang alveolar air pressure? Zero pala ang alveolar air pressure. So, since mas mataas ang 10 compared to zero during systole, blood flows, no, through the capillaries during systole. So, anong zone yan? Zone 1, 2, or 3? Zone 2. Kasi intermittent. During systole lang nagkakaroon ng blood flow. Puntahan natin yung diastole. During diastole, anong pulmonary arterial pressure? 8. Balikan natin para mas mapatunayan natin sa inyo. Oh, pulmonary artery during diastole 8. 8 millimeters mercury lang siya. Balik tayo. So 8 lang. Yung 8 millimeters mercury na yon, ideless mo pa ng 15, no? Ideless mo pa ng 15. So maging negative na, no? Negative 7 millimeters mercury. Ang negative 7 is less than the 0 alveolar air pressure. Thus, during diastole, blood cannot flow. Kaya talaga siyang zone 2. Kuha ba natin kung bakit walang blood flow? Yung 8 mo, 8 minus 15 maging negative 7. Negative 7 is less than the 0 alveolar pressure, di ba? 0 alveolar pressure. So since greater ang alveolar pressure, walang blood flow na mangyayari in the apex. Thus proven na zone 2. How about in the lower part of the lungs? So in the lower part of the lungs, the pulmonary arterial pressure in both systole and diastole is always greater than the 0 alveolar pressure. So, paano? So during systole, sabi natin 25, di ba? Mamaya nyo napansinin to ha, itong mga numbers na to. During systole, sabi natin 25 ang pulmonary arterial pressure in the heart. Tapos, in the lower part of the lungs, it is 8 millimeters greater than the heart. So, 25 plus 8, 33. So, 33 is greater than the 0 alveolar pressure. So, obviously, during systole, there will really be blood flow. The question is it the same during diastole? So, let me prove it. During diastole, it's 8 millimeters mercury. And then, in the lower part of the lungs, it is 8 millimeters mercury more than the heart. So 8 plus 8, 16. So 16 is still greater than 0. Thus, even during diastole, there is blood flow. So it is a continuous flow or zone 3 blood flow. Again, yung condition sa sinasabi natin, when the person is upright, pag nakatayo. Kasi nga, di ba, the hydrostatic pressure, yung 15 tsaka 8, applicable lang yun pag nakatayo. Now, when a person is lying down, pag nakahiga, no part of the lung is actually above the heart. So, nagiging pantay sila, di ba? Yung buong lungs mo, halos lahat ng buong lungs mo nasa ilalim ng heart mo. Thus, when we are lying down, all of the lungs become zone 3 blood flow. Even the apex. Naintindahan ba yun? Yung dinidiscuss natin na ito, it's only applicable when you are upright. Yung zone 2 and zone 3. But when you are lying down, everything becomes zone 3. Kasi no part of the lungs is above the heart. Now, when does a zone 1 blood flow happen? Zone 1 blood flow only happens under abnormal conditions. Okay? Diba? Yung zone 1, only when yung capillary pressure mo is lower than alveolar air pressure. Diba? Yun ang nangyari in zone 1. So, anong abnormal conditions yan? O let's say, upright yung person. But the person is breathing against positive air pressure. So, when there is positive air pressure, ang alveolar air pressure mo from 0, aakyat ng 10. Aakyat siya ng 10. So, mas malaki ngayon yung kailangan i-overcome ng heart mo. Diba? At 10 na din yung kanina, diba? Pansin nyo ba? 10 na din to, oh. During systole. So, 10, 10, walang difference. So, there will be no blood flow. No blood flow in the lung apex. Or, in an upright person, kapag may severe blood loss, bababa talaga ang systolic arterial pressure. Thus, zone 1 talaga yan. Now, what is the effect of exercise on blood flow? Ito yung siya, yung blue. So, we can see here that blood flow in all parts of the lungs will increase during exercise. In fact, the increase may reach up to 700 to 800% in the upper part of the lungs. Okay? So in the top of the lungs, the increase will even reach up to 700 to 800% increase. But in the lower part of the lungs, the increase will only be around 200%. Ganun lang kadami yung increase. So the pulmonary vascular pressure will rise enough during exercise. And you know what will happen? During exercise, it will convert the lung apices from zone 2 into zone 3 pattern. Okay? So, hindi lang nagiging zone 3 yung apex during lying down, but also during exercise. So, during heavy exercise, blood flow through the lungs will increase by around 4 to 7%. And this extra flow is accommodated in the lungs in 3 ways. Okay? Number 1, tumatanggap ang ating lungs ng extra blood by increasing the number of open capillaries by as much as 3-fold. Number 2, by distending all the capillaries and increasing the rate of flow by 2-fold. And lastly, by increasing the pulmonary arterial pressure. So, aralin natin what will be the effect of number 1 and number 2. So, by increasing the number of open capillaries and by distending the capillaries, what will be its effect? Bababa yung peripheral resistance. Nalala pa ba ninyo yung peripheral resistance? Yun yung normal impediment to blood flow. So, kapag in-extend mo or dinistend mo yung capillaries mo, bababa yung resistance. And pag bumaba ang resistance, what will be the effect? Bababa yung BP. So, that will be the effect. So, pag bumaba ang BP, bababa yung blood flow. Kita nyo ba yun? Kapag ginawa mo yung 1 and 2, bababa yung resistance. Pag bumaba yung resistance, bababa ang arterial pressure. Pag bumaba ang arterial pressure, bababa ang blood flow. So, why does the body do that? If that's the way to accommodate extra blood flow, then why does the body turn to 1 and 2? Diba? Instead of 3 agad. Okay. So, the first two changes decrease pulmonary vascular resistance so much that the pulmonary arterial pressure rises very little. Okay? Even during maximum exercise, hindi tataas yung pulmonary arterial pressure mo kung yung unang dalawa ang gagawin mo, increasing the number of open capillaries and distending all the capillaries. There will be minimal increase in the pulmonary arterial pressure. So, this ability of the lungs to accommodate increased blood flow without increasing pulmonary arterial pressure is actually protective for the heart. Okay? Kaya pala, yun ang pinipili ng heart natin na way or pinipili ng lungs natin na way para pataasin yung blood flow, no? By not allowing pulmonary arterial pressure to increase is to protect the heart, to conserve the energy of the right side of the heart and to prevent pulmonary edema. Yun pala yung reason. So, again, ang effect ng increasing the number of open capillaries and distending the capillaries is to decrease resistance. If resistance is decreased, arterial pressure will not increase or will be decreased. And why do we want that? Even during maximum exercise, bakit ayaw nating pataasin yung pulmonary arterial pressure to conserve the energy of the heart and to prevent pulmonary edema. So, balik lang tayo sa left atrium. Sabi natin kanina, left atrial pressure, paano kinukuha? By measuring wedge pressure. Sabi natin, ang normal wedge pressure, 5 millimeters mercury. So, 5 minus 2 or 3, that's your left atrial pressure. So, did you know that the left atrial pressure in a healthy person never rises above 6 millimeters mercury even during the most strenuous exercise? No? So, walang masyadong effect kay left atrial pressure yung exercise. Because the small changes in left atrial pressure will also have no effect on pulmonary circulation. So, ang ginagawa lang or ang nangyayari lang pag tumaas yung left atrial pressure mo, it just opens up more capillaries so that blood flow will continue to go to the pulmonary arteries. Again, kaya ganito is to protect the heart and to prevent pulmonary edema. However, when the left side of the heart fails, katulad ng sabi ko kanina, pagsira yung mitral valve, di ba? At hindi makapunta ang blood papunta sa left ventricle, the blood will again dam up in the left atrium. May ipon yung dugo sa left atrium. So, pag naipon ng dugo sa left atrium, the pressure will now increase. From the normal na 1 to 5 millimeters mercury, the pressure in the left atrium can go to the 40 to 50 millimeters mercury. Grabe, no? So, yung initial na rise kanina, di ba, very little effect on pulmonary function. But, pag lumagpas ng 7 or 8 millimeters mercury ang left atrium, there will be also a great increase in pulmonary arterial pressure. Ayan na. So, pag tumaas yung pulmonary arterial pressure, arteries, di ba, mabibigatan na rin ang right side of the heart. Pag mataas ang pressure ng pulmonary artery, mahihirapan ng right heart na buksan ang pulmonary artery. Okay? So, when the left atrial pressure rises above 30 millimeters mercury, there will be increase in capillary pressure na and pulmonary edema is likely to develop. Grabe. So, beyond 7 or 8, mahihirapan na ang right heart. Beyond 30, may pulmonary edema na tayo. Kaya, kita natin dito how protective, no? Yung mga pressures kanina. So, next, we'll be talking about the pulmonary capillary itself already. So, we'll now go into the specifics of the pulmonary capillary. Ang alveolar walls natin, itong mga alveoli natin, no, yan. Each of these are all alveoli. Our alveolar walls are lined up with so many capillaries, as you can see here. Madaming capillaries. These capillaries touch one another side by side. That's why capillary blood flow in the alveolar wall is considered a sheet of flow rather than individual capillaries. Meaning, pag may dugo na dumaan dito, hindi siya individually nangyayari. Lahat damay. Sheet of flow siya. Okay? Now, we've been mentioning pulmonary capillary pressure kanina, di ba? Ito yung kailangan mas mataas compared to alveolar air pressure para magkaroon ng blood flow sa zone 1, 2, and 3. Now, there is no direct way to measure yung pulmonary capillary pressure. So, how do they actually determine anong pressure ng pulmonary capillaries? Through isogravimetric measurements. Okay? So, ang nakuha nilang measurement ng pulmonary capillary is 7 millimeters mercury. And the mean left atrial pressure, sabi natin sa left atrium, pressure is only 2 millimeters mercury. Diba? So, the mean pulmonary capillary pressure should be somewhere between 2 and 15. Ulitin ko, sabi natin yung left atrium, 2 millimeters mercury. Sabi rin natin yung pulmonary arterial pressure, 15, diba? Doon sa apex. Thus, the capillary pressure in the apex must be somewhere between 2 and 15. And ang value na tinarget nila is 7 millimeters mercury. Okay. So, ang blood flow sa ating pulmonary capillaries actually mabilis lang. So, when the cardiac output is normal or kapag at rest yung person, yung blood flow sa pulmonary capillaries natin, it happens in about 0.8 of a second. But when the cardiac output increases, mas mabilis yung blood flow. It only happens in as fast as 0.3 seconds. So imagine, in only a fraction of a second, blood passing through the alveolar capillaries can immediately be oxygenated or can immediately lose their carbon dioxide. So ang bilis lang, no? 0.3 of a second, may oxygen na siya, wala na siyang carbon dioxide. And normally, 0.8 of a second, ganun lang. Bilis lang niya. So, the dynamics of fluid exchange across the lung capillaries are qualitative. Okay? qualitatively the same as for peripheral tissues. So, mamaya pupuntahan natin yung ibig sabihin ng qualitatively the same. Kasi yung pressures, maaaralin natin, almost the same. Pero quantitatively, doon yung difference, no? Okay. So, dito tayo magpo-focus. Sabi natin, anong pressure sa pulmonary capillary? 7 millimeters mercury. So, generally, it's low in comparison to yung capillaries found all over the body. So, yung capillaries found all over the body, they have a pressure of 17 millimeters mercury. But in the lungs, mababa, 7 millimeters mercury. Another difference, the interstitial fluid pressure in the lungs is more negative compared sa interstitial fluid pressure sa ibang parte ng katawan. So, in the lungs, it is negative 8 millimeters mercury. So, kanina sabi ko, di ba, capillary pressure, 7. And then, interstitial pressure in the lungs, negative 8. More negative yan compared to other parts of the body. And then, yung pulmonary capillaries natin are relatively leaky to protein molecules. Meaning, ang bilis-bilis makatakas ng protein molecules inside, from the capillaries papunta sa labas. This is because yung colloid osmotic pressure ng interstitial fluid is 14. So, 14 yung colloid osmotic pressure ng pulmonary interstitial fluid. Okay, papaliwanag ko kung ano yung colloid osmotic pressure. Colloid osmotic pressure, yan yung force that pulls proteins. Okay? So, 14 daw siya. So, hinihila niya yung proteins from inside the capillary papunta sa interstitial fluid. So, when you see osmotic, always think pulling force. Hinihila. Okay? So, alam na natin yung 7, alam na natin yung 8, alam na natin yung 14. Okay? So, as mentioned, your alveolar walls are extremely thin. And the alveolar epithelium covering their alveolar surfaces are also very weak. So, kung manipis at weak sila, they can easily rupture. No, they can easily rupture, especially if yung alveolar air pressure mo lalagpas ng zero. Okay? Mabilis daw masisira ang alveoli natin pag ang pressure sa alveoli ay lumagpas ng zero. Okay? So, ang ginagawa ng alveoli natin kapag tumataas yung pressure, it allows the dumping of fluid from the interstitial spaces into the alveoli. So, nag-accumulate siya ng fluid pag tumataas yung pressure. Okay, so, puntahan natin to, yung mga iba't ibang pressures found in our capillary and alveoli. So, in the pulmonary capillary, in the pulmonary alveoli, and in the lymphatic capillaries, meron tayong iba't ibang pressures. Okay? Umpisahan natin sa pressures causing the movement of fluid outward from the capillaries. Meaning, papalabas ng capillary. Okay? Papalabas ng capillary. Yung mga fluid, yung forces that causes fluid to get out of the capillary. Una, the capillary pressure. And we mentioned that to be 7. The capillary pressure is 7. So, ang ginagawa para ng capillary pressure na yun, it pushes fluid outside of the lungs. Also, we have the interstitial fluid colloid osmotic pressure. Diba? Ano nagkukos ng osmotic pressure? Yung proteins. Diba? Binanggit ko kanina. Yung protein molecules ang nagkukos niyan. So, 14. Ito siya. Diba? Anong ginagawa again ng osmotic pressure? It pulls fluid from the capillary papunta ng interstitial spaces. And then we also have the negative interstitial fluid pressure of negative 8 kanina. So, 8. So, add mo lahat yan. 7 plus 14 plus 8, the total outward force is 29. Okay? 29 millimeters mercury yung total outward force. Okay? Tandaan, 29 millimeters mercury yung puwersa na naglalabas ng fluid from the capillaries. How about the forces tending to cause absorption? There's only one, and that is your plasma colloid osmotic pressure. So osmotic, ano ulit yung nagkakos? Protein. So sa fluid portion ng blood natin, maraming protein ang blood, di ba? So yung protein na yun, it causes also a pulling force. Hinihila din niya, sorry, itong 28 na to, hinihila din niya yung fluid na nasa interstitial space papasok. So ang total inward ay 28 lamang. Thus, when you put 2 and 2 together, the normal outward force is slightly greater than the inward forces. So 29 minus the inward, which is 28, there is a mean filtration pressure of plus 1. Meaning, sa normal na pagkakataon, guys, fluid from inside the capillary would exit the capillary and go to the interstitium. Okay? Yun yung normal na nangyayari there because there is a mean filtration pressure. Okay? Nag-balance out yung mga yan. Okay? So, this filtration pressure causes a slight continual flow of fluid from the capillaries papunta ng interstitial spaces. Except for a small amount that evaporates in the alveoli. Diba? So, hindi naman lahat yun naiipon doon sa interstitial space. A small amount evaporates papasok ng alveoli, you know, pumapasok for evaporation, while some of it will go to the lymphatic system. Those fluid will go to the lymphatic system. Diba? Lymphatics taga-drain ng excess fluid. Diba? So, at this point, we are putting everything together now, ha? Pinagsasama-sama na natin lahat. So one of the most important problems in lung function is to understand kung bakit hindi napupuno yung alveoli natin with fluid. No? Sabi natin there is a continuous outflow. At small amount will go for evaporation, small amount would also go to the lymphatics. But how come it's never filled with fluid? This is because there are openings between the alveolar epithelial cells through which large protein molecules as well as water can pass. So you have these openings. You have one here, another one here, another one here. You have those openings where water and proteins can actually pass through. So pulmonary capillaries and the pulmonary lymphatic system will maintain a negative pressure. Ayun, no, minemaintain nila yung negative 8. Diba? Negative 8 here, ito naman negative 5. So this is made so that extra fluid that appears in the alveoli will be sucked mechanically into the interstitium through the pores of the alveoli. Kaya minemaintain nila yung negative para mahigop nila yung fluid na nilalabas ng capillaries natin. So this excess fluid is carried away through the lymphatics or is absorbed again by the osmotic pressure into the pulmonary capillaries. So under normal conditions, the alveoli are kept dry, except again for a small amount that enters the alveoli to keep it moist. Okay, so kahit na may normal net filtration kanina, di ba, plus one, you know, net pressure plus one. Kahit na may normal na lumalabas na fluid, the alveoli are kept dry because of that pressure that pulls it into the lymphatics and also yung evaporation. Now, we mentioned pulmonary edema. Kung ganun naman pala that the alveoli are kept dry, how does pulmonary edema occur? Pulmonary edema occurs in the same way that edema occurs elsewhere in the body. So, paano ba nangyayari yung edema or pamamanas in the different parts of the body? First, the blood vessels will constrict. Pag nag-constrict ang blood vessels mo, mag-i-increase ang lung pressure mo. Di ba? Mag-i-increase yung pulmonary arterial pressures natin. And any factor that causes an increase in the pulmonary interstitial fluid pressure will cause rapid filling of the interstitial spaces and alveoli with large amounts of free fluid. So, balikan ko lang. Yan. If in case tumaas, no, yung balikan ko lang to. Yan. If in case tumaas yung interstitial fluid pressures natin, tong interstitial fluid colloid osmotic pressure and negative interstitial fluid pressure, pag tumaas yan, dalawang yan, tataas yung outward force, di ba? Pag tumaas yung outward force, tataas yung mean filtration pressure. So, sabihin, tuloy-tuloy lalabas yung fluid. When that happens, that will be the mechanism for pulmonary edema to happen. Okay? So, what will happen to the alveoli? Mapupuno siya ng fluid. So, that's what happens. And what is the most common cause of pulmonary edema? A left-sided heart failure or a mitral valve disease. As mentioned, if blood cannot flow here in the mitral valve or bicuspid valve, no? Pag hindi makapunta yung blood or makalagpas yung blood sa bicuspid valve, maiipon yung blood sa left atrium. Pag naipon yung blood sa left atrium, babalik yung blood sa pulmonary veins. Pag naipon na yung blood sa pulmonary veins, babalik na siya sa lung tissue. And once fluid is increasing in the lung tissue, specifically sa capillaries natin, ano mangyayari? Tataas yung interstitial pressures. So that will happen. There will be flooding of the interstitial spaces and alveoli. Okay? So, what other causes aside from left-sided heart failure? Infections such as pneumonia or breathing noxious substances such as chlorine or sulfur. They can lead to damage sa pulmonary blood capillary membrane and even cause leakage of plasma proteins. Again, pag nag-leak ang proteins, anong gagawin ng proteins? It will pull fluid from the capillaries papunta ng interstitial spaces. And again, mapupuno ang alveoli ng fluid. Okay? So, there is such a thing called pulmonary edema safety factor. So, this is a way of the body to protect itself from the development of pulmonary edema. Okay? So, remember that every time the left atrial pressure rises, di ba, pag tumataas ang left atrial pressure natin, the pulmonary capillary pressure also rises. Okay? So, if the left atrial pressure rose above 23 millimeters mercury, the fluid will begin to accumulate in the lungs. Okay? So, yun yung, ano natin, minimum. Pag ang left atrial pressure above 23 na, magsa-start na maipon ang fluid in the lungs. Tapos, sabi natin kanina, if you still remember, pag lumagpas siya ng 30, definitely magkakaroon na ng pulmonary edema or may pulmonary edema ka na. So, we mentioned that the normal plasma colloid osmotic pressure is 28. Ito yung nagpo-pull ng fluid pabalik sa capillary, 28, no? So, pulmonary capillary pressure must rise from the normal of 7 to greater than 28 to cause pulmonary edema. Meaning, itong 7 na to, kailangan malagpasan niya itong 28 para mag-cause ng pulmonary edema. So, yung difference nila na negative 21, that is the pulmonary edema safety factor. So, when the pulmonary capillary pressure remains elevated for at least 2 weeks, no, pag mataas ang pulmonary capillary pressure natin for at least 2 weeks, the lungs will become even more resistant to pulmonary edema. So, kapag mataas daw ang pulmonary capillary pressure mo for at least 2 weeks, pipilitin labanan ng lungs mo na mag-develop ng pulmonary edema. Bakit? Paano gagawin? Yung lymphatic vessels mo mag-e-expand. At pag nag-expand yun, mag-i-increase yung ability nila to carry fluid away from the interstitial spaces by tenfold. So, mas lalakas yung pagsipsip niya ng excess fluid. No? In patients with chronic mitral stenosis or dun sa mga may paninikip ng mitral valve, their pulmonary capillary pressures will increase up to 40 to 45. Sobrang taas ng pulmonary capillary pressure nila. And in patients na mayroong chronic problems, hindi sila nagkakaroon, no? di sila nagkakaroon ng pulmonary edema kasi ito yung nangyayari. Natitrain yung lymphatic vessels to absorb more. Okay? So, pag may chronic problem, doon nag-a-apply yung safety factor. However, kapag rapid yung increase, no? Pag rapid yung increase in pulmonary capillary pressure, if it happens within hours or even within minutes, then it will be lethal. Pwedeng mamatay yung patient because of it. The last part of our discussion will be about fluid in the pleural cavity. So when the lungs expand and contract during normal breathing, no, napoprotect yung lungs natin by this fluid formed inside the pleural space. So tapos na tayo sa pleural edema, tapos na tayo kanina dun sa fluid inside the alveoli. Lumabas na tayo. Nandun na tayo ngayon sa pleural cavity. This fluid over here found between the parietal and visceral membrane. Ito na yung pinag-uusapan natin. So our lungs are protected from friction by this fluid, no? By this pleural fluid. So the pleural fluid is a thin layer of mucous fluid between the parietal and visceral pleura. So ano ba yung pleural membrane? The pleural membrane is a porous mesenchymal serous membrane through which fluid continually flow into. So, from our blood vessels, there is daw a continuous flow of fluid papunta doon sa pleural membrane natin. And this fluid na pumapasok carry with them proteins. No, and these proteins give the fluid a mucoid characteristic, allowing yung parang smooth movement of the lungs, no, or that parang mucoid protection of the lungs. So the total amount of fluid in each pleural cavity is only a few ml. And paano ba na-maintain na only a few ml lang yung meron? So when the quantity becomes more than normal, the excess fluid is pumped away by lymphatic vessels. And where can we find our lymphatic vessels? You find them in your mediastinum. So kita nyo, no, yung excess fluid surrounding your parietal and visceral, yung iba pumupunta sa mediastinal lymphatics. Yung iba, they go to the superior surface of the diaphragm. Ito yung diaphragm. So superior surface of the diaphragm. And some go to the parietal pleura. You know, coastal. So ganyan sila na reabsorb para hindi maipon yung fluid in the pleural space. So the pleural space is a space between the parietal and the visceral pleura. It's called a space because it is a potential location. It's a potential area, meaning pwedeng magkaroon siya ng laman. Yeah. So itong ating membrane has a negative force, di ba? I think na-mention natin to in our previous discussion. There is a continuous negative force that pulls the lungs to keep it expanded, no? So, the cause of this negative pressure, ano ba yung nagkukause ng negative pressure na yan? It is, if you still remember, it is the sucking of the lymphatics. Kaya siya fully expanded. Kaya hindi siya nag-recoil. It's because of that continuous sucking of the lymphatics. So, normal collapse tendency of the lungs is negative 4 millimeters mercury. Thus, yung pleural fluid pressure must always be at least negative 4. Okay? Pag umangat more than negative 4, magko-collapse yung lungs natin. So, dapat negative siya lagi, negative 4. A few millimeters mercury more than the negative will cause collapse of the lungs. Okay? So, the negativity of the pleural fluid keeps the lungs pulled against the parietal pleura. So, yun yung humihila doon sa ating parietal pleura. So, what is pleural effusion? It is the collection of fluid in the pleural space or also known as the edema of the pleural cavity. So what happens or what causes pleural effusion? Number one, pag may blockage sa lymphatic drainage, di ba? Pag wala na nag-absorb dun sa extra fluid, malamang may ipo na talaga yung fluid. Number two, cardiac failure. So pag may heart failure, parang kanina binanggit natin sa pulmonary edema, di ba? Babalik yung blood. Diba, babalik yung blood sa iba't ibang parts from the left, babalik ng pulmonary vein, babalik ng lungs. From the lungs, pwedeng bumalik ng right ventricle, pwedeng bumalik ng right atrium, etc. So that cardiac failure will lead to excessive transudation of fluid into the pleural cavity. Meaning kapag naipon na yung blood dito sa mga blood vessels na to, it will cause fluid to go out. At may ipon yung fluid na yan sa pleural space natin. And third is a greatly reduced plasma colloid osmotic pressure. Again, osmotic, caused by proteins. Anong ginagawa ng colloid osmotic pressure? Hinihila niya. So, yung pressure found in the blood vessels na humihila ng fluid from the space pabalik ng blood vessels, kapag yun bumagsak, ano mangyayari? Wala na magpo-pull ng fluid pabalik. So, puro push na lang ng fluid. So, it will cause excessive transudation of fluid. And lastly, any infection will cause transudation. And that's the end of the discussion. Thank you, guys.